My name is Danielle Spiegelfeld. I'm the Executive Director of the Guarini Center in Environmental Energy and Land Use Law here at the Law School. And on behalf of our faculty, Richard Stewart and Katrina Wyman, as well as all of our affiliated fellows and staff, I would like to warmly welcome you to this event entitled Expanding Green Roofs in New York City, a Dialogue with the City of Copenhagen. So I'm going to keep my remarks very brief because, as I mentioned, we have an incredibly full program. But just to sort of set things off with a little bit of context, I think it's worthwhile to think about exactly how much area of New York is devoted to roofs. Rooftops account for about 13% of the total land area in New York, or about 40 square miles, which, just to give one more visual, is approximately 30 central parks laid next to each other. And so I think it's pretty clear that for the city to effectively achieve a number of its environmental objectives, from reducing emissions 80% by 2050 to dramatically reducing stormwater, we're going to need to develop this resource in a more sustainable manner than we have been through the sort of sporadic green or solar projects that we currently have. And I think it's pretty clear to most of us, at least those of us who are going to talk or who have had a role in convening the panel tonight, that green roofs are an important part of the strategy going forward. And so our goal as we think about what New York City can do to accelerate the transition toward sustainable rooftops is to talk with our peers from the City of Copenhagen, who have a wealth of experience in this field. Copenhagen in 2010 became the first city in Scandinavia to mandate that some new construction, certain types of new construction, incorporate green roofs, and I think they've seen a fairly significant growth in vegetated roofs since then in both the private and public sector buildings. So the question for us tonight is, what can we learn from the Danish experience? How does it compare to the experiences that we've had with green roofs in New York today? And how should it inform our thinking about the next generation of policy tools to develop here? Fortunately, we have a great group of experts here from both Copenhagen and New York to examine the questions at hand. And I'm just going to give two short excuses. One is that I'm not going to present detailed bios. You have those in writing because, again, there's a lot of speakers and we have very little time. And the other is that I will most likely butcher the names of the Danes, and I apologize for that. But for anyone who's tried to speak Danish, it is no easy feat, I can assure you. So we're going to begin the program with two short presentations by Danish urban planners and architects who have a wealth of experience in designing and implementing green roofs. First up, we're going to have Mette Schuld, is that close enough? who is with SLA Architects, and then she'll be followed by Herbert Dreiseitl. Maybe that's even worse than I got your name. After that, we're going to have a panel discussion led by Professor Rebecca Bradspies of CUNY School of Law. And she'll be leading the discussion with Jakob Larsen, who's a director at Orbicon and chairman of the Environment and Climate Committee for the Danish Association of Consulting Engineers, as well as Lucky Leonardson, who's head of the Resilient and Sustainable City Solutions for the City of Copenhagen, Max Lerner, Sustainability Development Coordinator, see, I can't even get the English now, for the New York City Department of Parks and Recreation. And last but not least, Alan Steele, CEO of the Javits Center, which, as you'll learn, has completed quite an impressive green roof project on its own building. So before I hand it over to Mette, I just wanted to extend a very warm and special thank you to our partners in the Danish Cleantech Hub. Without their support, this event would certainly not be possible. So thank you both very much to Klaus and Tone. It's been wonderful working with you. Thank you for everything. Okay. So, Mette. One of those waters is mine. I forget which. Sorry.
Thank you. Very nice to be here. Very nice to see you all here. We had two fantastic days with Max and New York Parks and Danish Cleantech Hub, and today we went to a lot of sites. So that was a very constructive dialogue. I have some groundbreaking news about this project. This is our latest conceptual design for cloudburst and rainwater management for the City of Copenhagen. It's one of the largest projects for doing that in the surface of Copenhagen. Yesterday night, we won the World Landscape Award of Excellence for this project. And Christian, that is there from Ramboll, he didn't even know. I don't think so. So cities of nature is what we work with. We enjoy nature, we study nature. Nature is the launch pad of everything we do. Now I can see if I can shift. Okay. Another announcement is that we've done research and communication on why we love trees and what tree performs in our cities. And this was also given a World Landscape Award for communication and research yesterday night. So it's a shared publication, so you can go to our website and find it. The initial idea here was to communicate both to politicians, but also to school children, why we should love and enjoy our trees in our cities. So nature is the focal point of everything we do. It's kind of the launch pad. And it's because nature is a part of all life. It's a living material. It's an abundance of knowledge. We just enjoy that and fully love it. And think that to reconnect people with nature and the senses of nature and the performance of nature in our cities is a really, really strong asset for us. We're a multidisciplinary team. We have three offices. We're around 60 people. We are all from researchers, specialists, to landscape architects, to urban planners, biologists, even an anthropologist, because of the social processes and values that we create. The company is owned by three partners that you see here. We do projects all over the world, but we always seek for the right project with the right people. It's very important for us to understand the right and the specific context. So we do everything from cloudburst, rainwater management, to actually security and access regulating a dense city and for the livability of the city. So we do all kinds of projects, but not buildings. Sorry, this is a little bit slow. Yeah, so again, nature is the launch pad. So sometimes we start differently. We go to see where does the materials come from. If you have a paving, you can actually save a lot of resources by understanding the nature of the paving and how it's processed. And we have Morten here as well. He's our plant and specialist. So yeah, we start somewhere different. We conducted a think tank for the City of Copenhagen on nature-based design and how we can both use nature as a performance utility service. It can perform, it can clean air, it can clean water, it can create a microclimate, it can reduce noise, it can even minimize our CO2 footprint. But on the same time, it's also important for us about the belonging, about all the senses, how to create a neighborhood, all the social values, all this about being a person and doing livability in the city. So we did this Copenhagen model that was an outcome of the think tank. And we also have this catalog of climate adaptation and urban nature. So this cloudburst management plan of Copenhagen, how can this leave Copenhagen greener and better for the citizens? And it's all evidence-based by the assessment tool, going back to the Brundtland report, who was the first to coin the triple bottom value of social, economic, and environmental values. So this is also accessible on our website. So now into green roof. This is a little bit tricky. Come on, you can do it. No more slides. All right. Okay, Max just gave me a note here that maybe you don't know what cloudburst is or stormwater. It's heavy rain. Copenhagen, yeah, you are nodding. Mm-hmm. Copenhagen suffered from a 1,000-year event in 2011 that completely paralyzed the city. And the damage, the aftermath of recovering and getting the city back to normal was accumulated to around $1 billion. So that equation is easy to make. How can we leave the city more resilient for the next events? And we know they will come. So this is the first green roof of Copenhagen that is fully climate and rainwater adapted. It also has a security regulating in the design. It's a bank on a corner, and we didn't do the buildings, but we did the urban space in between. It's called the City Dune. The idea was to do a long ramp, and we got a little bit more out of it. So a long ramp for all the bicyclists, we bike a lot in Copenhagen, and for all the pedestrians to actually get up to a roof garden. I'm sorry about this. Your fault. Okay, next. So the idea was to get us up to the roof garden that is not really there, but that is the green rectangular. So get us from 0 to +7. That was, and this was the starting point. Next. So we did this roof garden. So it's basically on top of a parking lot. Yeah. And this is how it looks. It's a long ramp. It's climate adapted in many ways. It's a light concrete, so it doesn't accumulate heat to the heat island effect. It reflects like snow does. It has a high albedo effect. It doesn't accumulate, so it's and it recollects all the everyday rain in a natural and clean it through a natural filter underneath, and then use it for irrigation, but also for cooling down the surface on hot summer days. And it does grow, and it's because we know how to construct this. So the trees does grow. So this is here. This is handing it over to the client, and this is 3 years after. Next. And people use it. So it's a whole different atmosphere of being a bank in the city center. And it has all the security regulations as well. So it's integrated into a design, but it's a whole new brand of a bank in a city. Normally banks, they are really like Fort Knox, you know. Mm-hmm. All right. And here you see the between the slabs, we have these dilatation, between the concrete slabs. So you collect the water and use it for irrigation. It's the same type of product that we have for keeping crops and fruits fresh in our grocery stores. It's very cheap. And it also has an aesthetic effect, you know? It catches sunlight during morning. Come on, next. And this is on a snowy day. So it's also prepared for the load of snow, and it's a beautiful landscape during summer. Celebrating summer. And this is just to show you from a perspective that we did this roof, and then to your right, and then this roof as well to reconnect. So it's not a high line, but it's connecting green roofs to actually cherish the soft traffickers of the city. So this green roof we did too. Next. Seen like this, it's a conference center. It's all public accessible. Next. During night. We also work with light. And these two projects made the city of Copenhagen rethink how can we interconnect more spaces like this and actually create new routes and new spaces in the city. Next. I just wanted to show you this Novo Nordic. It's a pharmaceutical company. They work with triple bottom line, so it's very important innovation. They have these copyrights that run out. They need to innovate their pharmaceutical production all the time. They have these small red plastic cubes. That is their innovation cubes. So we challenge them a little bit and say, okay, but all medicine actually comes from nature as a start. So why don't you use nature as your innovation lab? And why don't you take a walk in the park and be present? And we're quite sure that your innovation rate will then raise. So this is actually Novo Nordisk Innovation Lab. And they decided to move their headquarters into an old production facility. So it's a smaller industry area, a little bit outside of Copenhagen, yes. And this is the time lapse from start to construction, site preparation, the two headquarter buildings, and then handing it over to the client 2015. Two-thirds of it is a roof garden where you have the parking underneath. And this is the site today. And I guess you all here know Kierkegaard. It's a philosopher, a Danish philosopher. If you don't know, I know how I'm done. But he's famous for having said that He has walked his way to all his great thoughts, but he has also walked away from all his illnesses and all his... So it's good to walk and talk, and we have actually been inspired by the Japanese way of working with nature. So we have trees just in the middle of the road. So you can't, you have to be present. You can't just walk there and look into your iPhone or whatever you want. So you have to be present. Yes? Oh, that's the opposite way. This project is storm-proven. It's detached from all the utilities. So Novo Nordisk, they actually get money for not, using the system for cleaning. They use the water in a whole system of a whole water ecosystem, you could say a whole hydrological system, and it has a tank, a reservoir that uses the water both in the maintenance of the building, but also in the irrigation for this nature. Next. And then when we bought all these trees from the plant nurseries, and that's really that's what we enjoy at the office, to go out there and actually buy the trees. Some of the larger trees, they died on the transportation from the plant nursery. And then we challenged these maintenance persons, say, okay, but if you want to do really good for your nature park, you need to have the dying trees in your park. That would increase the biodiversity and nurture new species. So we convinced them. Next. And Novo Nordisk, they monitor species, and there's a special bumblebee found out there. And it got the Danish award, landscape award, last year from the Minister of Culture, yes? So last, we won a project in Paris. Paris is in Europe the most air-polluted city. And it's increasing, it's densifying, people are moving into the city. And the idea here was to convert cubic meters of air polluted, extremely polluted air around the periphery, that's the perimeter around Paris, into a living space, yes, by not only looking at a roof, but looking at how can the performance of a whole urban space, including the facades and the roofs and the ground level, into this ecosystems of cleaning air and creating a livable environment for the people. So how to include the hydrological circuit, yes, with the biological circuit, including all kinds of mushroom, fungi are performing extremely well into this project, and introducing the first tea saloon on top of the roof garden. Teas as a species has this perfect performance of not including the polluted air. So it can still be clean, and you can have this first flush of tea. And since the dynamics of climate, it's feasible to actually grow tea in Paris. So we, of course, have a tea saloon included. And the next one. That's it.
We had an amazing excursion this afternoon, and I actually got stuck, and I was at the wrong entrance. So I really apologize for that. Well, I would like to continue with my keynote about what could we do for transfer of knowledge, and I have some examples from the US and some examples from Europe and from Denmark, especially. So we have just to see if we can open it. Is that the right one? and must have the date from today. Hopefully it works. Okay, I just introduce, and I hope the right PowerPoint will come up. My name is Herbert Dreiseitl. I'm part of the Livable City Lab. I'm leading the Livable City Lab in Ramboll, a big company based in Copenhagen with a headquarters there. But we also have a lot of connections here to the US with our new group, Environ, which is included into Ramboll. So Ramboll Environ. And I would like to, how can I continue here? To focus a bit on this question, when we talk about green roofs and green solutions in our cities, what is it about? It's really very much about how can we bring more environmental opportunities in a more dense situation of a city. And can I go forward with this one? You have to go forward. Just go forward. So we can see if we take notice of that or not, we can see there's a big change in temperature and intensity of rain. Next one. Certainly we can see we have much more intense rain showers, flooding, but the other side is also that we have not enough rain and not enough water in our cities. So it's getting very hot. We have big problems in Europe. We have big problems here also in the US. And this will be more and more the case. Next one. The real question is, how can we actually come to a more resilient system in our cities? At the moment, actually, our old system actually often fail, and they are not flexible enough to handle the challenge. Next one. So we have actually this point about opportunities, and we talk about blue-green infrastructure, but a city is about people, and it's about what value can we add to the society. And I think that's very important. Next one. I would like to focus a bit on this question, where the green roof situated, actually. We have this, we are going basically from an old system where we have to get rid of water as quick as possible to a more integrated approach. Next one. And we have different kinds of tool sets. One is more about quantity, and the other one is about quality. Next. And now I would like to talk a bit about green roofs. Green roofs are really then on the top. Next one, just go very quick over. So green roofs and facades, green roofs. Green roof experience in Europe, especially also in Germany, you hear it on my accent. I have been working a lot for Berlin Potsdamer Platz, where we have a lot of green roofs in the city. We treat the water right on the top, bring it down, store it, recycle it, bring it into a lagoon system where the water can go up and down, and we can filter and hold back the water. We can even recycle it. Next one. This means for a bigger city, a totally different atmosphere of the microclimate, and of course also an improvement of the flora and fauna in the city, and biodiversity. Next one. Today, the experience of Potsdamer Platz was very, very successful. We just have here rainwater, but this is of course a very extreme case where we actually collect the water. At that time, it was Daimler Chrysler. Next one. As a private investor, together with the city. We also filter to get rid of nutrients and have a better water quality, finally, as outcome. Next one. So the water is crystal clear, but it's just the runoff of streets and the runoff of rooftops in the dense city of Berlin. So with this experience, actually, we also have been able to work in Chicago. Go to the next slide, please. And we were actually starting in to help the mayor of Chicago with his rooftop for the Chicago City Hall. And that was an interesting experience. We did work together with Conservation Design Forum. And I had to bring over the technology from Europe, basically. And we had the experiment to work on one side on the City Hall, just a gray and asphalt rooftop. And the other one was actually a green roof. And we made the experiments to see what's the difference in temperature and also in biodiversity. And just have a look at the next picture. They speak for themselves. Yeah, we have honey, and it's, the mayor is proud, really, to have his own honey on the rooftop of the city hall. That's really a wow, to give this to, as a small present to someone. Next. It's also very educative for kids, you know, to go there, to see what is really the environment doing, even in a dense city. How can we bring back dragonflies right into the city of Chicago? Next one. That's it today, and I think it was a really good experience. You need somehow really good projects to bring it over. Go to the next slides, please, very quick. go to the surface. Now, green roofs have to be always in a context to other things. And I would like to take that example here from Portland, the Tennis Springs Park. Project, go please quickly do the next one. I just go very quick through. I don't want to go over time. This is Pearl District. And in the Pearl District, go to the next, please. We have this situation that we could work on a public park in the center of the Pearl District. It's part of a big master plan from Peter Walker. So I did design with Greenworks, with my team, this central park here. We collect the water from all different sites. We bring it into the park. Go to the next, please. Just go quickly through. I say slow when it's too fast. We infiltrate some. We clean it. And go to the next one, and we also recycle it. We use the park as a filtration system. We use actually the ecosystem as a cleansing function beside that we have retention. And we use actually integrated, not only bioswales, but also really a kind of cleansing biotope in the park, which also brings then a lot of co-benefits to the park and to the society. Next pictures, please. We did also public participation workshops. That's very important. You have to get the people on board to show the win effect and to show what could the future look like. And I think that's very important. We did talk a lot in our workshop about this. Next one. Today, this is a very beautiful park, very little maintenance because people love it and they take care. So there's very little vandalism. Next one. People use it also for leisure, coming together, school classes come to learn about nature in the city. Next one. People have all kinds of things here. And if you're lucky, go to the next one. You can see an osprey catching a fish. And actually, I got this picture from a taxi driver just passing by and making this photo. So all kinds of things can happen if you combine that. Next one. So just go quickly to the last ones here. This, I think we skipped this. Just go over. Well, no, this is maybe on one point good, because this is Queen's Botanical Garden. Queen's Botanical Garden, we did work on the park. We made the general restoration of the park. And we have a green roof, which is also combined to a larger story, to a larger system. Next one. Actually, the park in itself, we try to have zero run out. So we try to infiltrate, next one, into the ground. You will see this in a short moment. Next one. Just go quickly through. Next one. Next one. And we also harvest the water, the rainwater, from the rooftop in a holding lake and infiltrate the rest what we don't need. But we also celebrate the water. We bring it back, and if you have the chance to go in, also these days is wonderful. To see, go to the next one, to see the fountain. This is actually harvested rainwater from the rooftops. The water is going through the building, going into this tank, and the green roof is in a part of that. Next one. So these are some impressions of this project. Next one. And this is the green roof going up to the top. So people can walk over the green roof, and underneath there's a hall where you can have functions and gatherings. Next one. So that we also have a waterfall to show when it rains, because that's cool, you know, to see how much water is actually coming down and not to hide it, but really to show it. I think water in a city is something wonderful, is something very important, and we have also to not only to hide it, but also to show when it is possible. Next one. So the park is heavily used in many different ways, and I think Queens is a wonderful place with so many different languages, so many different people, and this is really something. To talk about environment and about water is bringing the society together. No matter what religion, no matter what kind of type of person you are, there's something we all have in common. Next. Next. This is a car parking runoff. All the water actually there is also treated on site. Go quickly to the next ones. And is infiltrated here in the ground. It's very simple. You usually don't see the water. Only if it rains very heavily, you will see the water. So I think stormwater management in a city has to be done very intelligent. You need hydrology, you need to make it really good, but you also have to design it in the right way. Next one. Yeah, and then finally, I come to the end. I show one example. We did work actually very close together with SLA on this project. Go to the next one. This is actually a project which is also integrating a stormwater treatment in a dense city of Copenhagen. Go to the next one, please, very quick. So the situation is here that we have actually a stripe, a park, a church, and a street. And the street goes into one kind of lagoon system where we can also use the rainwater to bring that in, and the water level in this lagoon can also go up and down. We implemented that to have a retention function and detention function in the city. Next one. So it needs a very proper and very good planning of that. Next one. And then you have to work really in the details. Next. And then finally integrate the hydraulic system into a good design system of the city. Next. And it actually is a storyline of the water which is actually uniting the different parts of the city, connecting the parks to the waterfront. Next. And actually, it's also important, go quickly to the next one, I want to get to the end. Okay, stop here. It's also interesting to show the performance of a really good water design in a city, what would happen if it is a rainy day, and the next, what is happening if it is a sunny day. So there are different ways of performing this kind of systems. And well, we are really excited, all of us, to have a kind of bridge of sharing our knowledge with you. And also, it's a journey. We know that we are not at the end of this development. We know that a lot of people around the world are actually looking and urgently looking for better systems in our cities to make our cities more livable, more resilient, and more sustainable. Thank you very much.
Okay, so now that we've had some inspiration, Rebecca.
Well, thank you both very much. As I look out these windows, I sure wish I were seeing some of that beautiful green. And you know, I think that New York is a place that is in desperate need of the kind of stories we just heard and has incredible potential to move us forward. We have this wonderful panel of experts to learn from today, and because we're in a law school, and because I'm a law professor, I want to start with the legal and regulatory system that has helped this happen, or at least allowed this to happen, in Copenhagen. So if you could tell us just a little bit about how you got to the point of having a green roof mandate, and how that is implemented, and then we'll hear about how that differs here in New York.
Well, we started working with green roofs back in 2008, mm-hmm. Looking into the possible potential of that. And it was basically one very, very dedicated person in the administration. You always need one like that to drive the process through, who was very active in saying, how can green roofs perform in different aspects? And it ended up with us having basically a regulation that in all local planning, whenever there were new developments, if you had roofs with a gradient of less than 30 degrees, mm-hmm. you had to put in a green roof. And if you did not put in a green roof, you had to have very good arguments against it. And it's been the politicians. It wasn't easy because the way the planning legislation is put together in Denmark makes it very difficult. I mean, we can have all kinds of regulations on what kind of bricks people should be using, the colors and the size of the windows and all things. But actually, sort of things like green roofs and these things have to be more or less, it's very difficult to make them sort of binding, really binding. So it's a lot of, it had to have that political mandate, and we couldn't get it as binding as we really wanted it to. So that means that there are also loopholes for developers to get out of it, and they are using them if they can.
Oh, sorry, can you speak just for a minute about sort of where we are in New York City, and then we'll do a little more comparison?
Absolutely. So more locally, There's a number of agencies working on resiliency features for the city, both on the city level and independently, in privates and nonprofits. There's, of course, all of this collectively built into the mayor's One NYC plan. There's mixed incentive programs from different city agencies. It's definitely moving in a positive direction, but it's still very much a hodgepodge. So I do dream of approaching the Copenhagen model, where it's mandated, where we have a very clear system, a very obvious way where anyone, whether they're coming from the city or they're coming from residents, anyone from any sector can say, all right, I want to build a green space project on my facility. Here are the clear incentives. Here's the clear way to do it. Here's a list of people to contact. And here's the free ways that we can start to really expedite this work. So it's there, the framework's there, but it's still very much all over the place. But it's very quickly growing in speed as we realize, especially in a post-Sandy New York City, how important this work really is to prevent the next 100-year storm.
Oh, it's not going to happen again.
No.
Yeah. So can you just describe a little bit, like, how
can I just jump in on the New York City thing, because I don't know whether everyone knows, but just so you do, we actually have the second largest green roof in the country in New York City. It's on the roof of the Javits Center. We have a 6.75 acre green roof that was installed from 2012 to 2014. So it is happening. It's not happening because it's mandated. And in our case, it happened because it made economic sense. We were able to put the roof in for no more than it would have cost to re-roof the existing building. So I think mandating this is one way of approaching it. But I think looking at this from an economic perspective is also an important element.
And I guess that's really where I was going
to
go with the question.
Sorry,
so thank
didn't
mean
you.
To no, thank you so much. I would imagine that there are, in New York, that there are tremendous hurdles. Some of them may be cost-based, but a lot of them just have to be logistical. So in Copenhagen, what have you found to be the barriers that people have had to deal with in the process of building? And, you know, which ones were unexpected, I guess?
Well, I mean, one of the obvious barriers is that a lot of the houses in Copenhagen have steep roof. So, I mean, there's a limit to where you can actually use it. It's not like here when I look out the window from my hotel room, I only see flat roofs. So there's a huge potential here, which we don't have in Copenhagen. But, I mean, one of the things I think maybe it's a traditional thinking in developers, the fear of the unknown. They think that a green roof that's supposed to store water, that can only, if we look back sort of historically in Denmark, they started building houses with flat roofs in the 60s. And we had lots and lots of scandals of leaking flat roofs because it rains a lot in Denmark. And I think this sort of has kept in the mind of many developers. Also in municipal developers, I mean, it's not just the private developer, it's also when we talk to people in the municipality about it, they see it as a troublemaker. They find it, they actually don't know what to do about it. So there's this insecurity of lack of knowledge on that. That's one thing. The other thing is that it might be a little more costly in the when we are building, but maybe you can actually save on maintenance costs. And to actually make that picture clear is also an obstacle for private developers, also because in Denmark, the developers will very often sell the buildings right after construction. And so they're not so concerned about they're concerned about the price of construction, not so much about the maintenance, because somebody else will have to deal with that later on. So they want to save. So I think that's some of the main obstacles that we've met. And I think sort of the traditional thinking is the one that has surprised me the most, that there was actually this lack of knowledge and this fear of using unknown or unfamiliar building processes in that.
So Jacob, have you... I mean, I think that would be something you might have some experience with to weigh in here.
Not actually, but I agree with Lykke. There's a big fear of keeping water on the roof. It might damage the building, people tend to think. So of course, this is a great obstacle for developers to go into solutions with green roofs.
So just from the experience of having a large green roof, and with, as many of you might know, the Javits Center having been built in 1986, we had a lot of leaks in the Javits Center roof from 1986 onwards, partly because the technology at the time was not as developed as it is. Since we installed the green roof, we have no leaks. We retain 80% of any storm in our roof materials, which actually is only 1 inch deep. It is not a heavy surface up there. We retain 80% of the stormwater runoff, and we actually find that the insulative values that we get with the green roof, it keeps the building cooler in the summer, it keeps the building warmer in the winter. We saved $3 million on our electric bill last year, which is about 25% of our overall bill. So there are some costs associated with it. Increasingly, those costs are not significant, and the ongoing costs of that you can save, the ongoing savings are very significant.
Just to echo Alan, I mean, it's not an open question at this point. The paybacks are there, the environmental benefits are there, the logistical benefits are there, structural benefits are there. We can collect X, Y, and Z data on it, but it is very, very universally proven. But as our representatives from Copenhagen brought up, although it's completely proven across the board that these systems make sense, there is this great bias we have to overcome of convincing people that these new and interesting things are feasible in our city, and there are many beautiful installations out there. I really admire the Javits system because it's one of the ways that we can actually start to make these systems be more tangible to the public. We can talk about these systems here, but they still kind of become these pie-in-the-sky ideas until you actually get people out there and they say, oh, wow, here's a paper on it, but also I can see it functioning here in the urban environment. I can see that it's saving the Javits money. I can see that the system is thriving year after year after year, and it's beautiful, and it's environmentally sound. These systems are not dreamscapes anymore. They're very real, and it's a beautiful thing to be able to contribute to that.
And maybe we also lack to tell the stories like Mette and Herbert were telling about what we can also get out of green roofs. The fact that again, looking out, I mean, just here in Manhattan, I mean, apart from Central Park, it's very gray here. There are lots of trees in some parts, but there's a lack of green space for people. And this is a huge potential also for recreational areas, for citizens in a city where there's a lack of green space. So just saying, this is not just about stormwater retention, it's not just about insulations, it's actually also has that extra effect of doing something which is important for the citizens. And then you can add also the possibility to work with biodiversity, the fact that you can have, I mean, normally when you think of green roofs, you think about like sedum and not very interesting, but you can do a lot of things which can be combined with recreative purposes and give and also help the local biodiversity in a city and become a very important part. One of the things that are lacking in cities are the connections between green spaces. You might have a park in one area, but if you have 2 miles until the next park, it's very far for birds and insects and so on to move. But if you have green roof, they will work as stepping stones also on the way between these areas. So you can have that connectivity, which will actually allow for better habitats for different species in the city, which will also be beneficial for people living there. I think it's fun to see different things, different insects and bumblebees and whatever it is.
Yeah. Well, what has been the experience in terms of increased biodiversity, both in Copenhagen and then what is your experience and what are the park's hopes?
Well, our experience has been, and let me tell you a little bit of a story. We Javits has spent a lot of time telling everyone about how much economic impact we create for the city, and no one ever pays any attention to it. We send out a press release telling everyone that we had 15 species of birds active on the roof, and I had NBC at the door with a camera crew within a day. So our experience has been very positive. We are not a publicly accessible roof, which is one of the things I regret, but we do make the roof accessible to the public through a sign-on program that we have. We are open to people. You go to the website, you sign on there, or we have a program called Javits Juniors, where we bring local schools in and teach them about biodiversity. We teach them about what we do at the convention center too, but we try and do the community activities. We can't be a park just because of the nature of the building we are and the age of the building and the structure. But we reach out as much as we can to try and address some of those issues. We've also, working with Max and with Rebecca Marshall, my sustainability manager, who's sitting in the back there, developed a program where we are working with other green roofs in New York City to develop a database to share information so that we can talk to people about what the value of these projects are and how you can use them both economically and also from a biodiversity perspective. We work with Drexel University, with Fordham, we work with the Audubon Society, we're just initiating a microbe study so we can fully understand what happens on the roof, and then the intention is to try and use that with others to inform people about how this can also be valuable for them too.
And in Copenhagen, one of the things that we've done is developed what we call a greening assessment tool, which is basically looking at not just the roof, but the entire surroundings of a building to see how much green can we have in that area, not just looking at quantity, but also at quality. So it's not just, I mean, there's a difference between putting in a one inch sedum green roof or a green roof where you have native plants and the possibility for habitats for animals and other things. So you will have that and in the regulations for new buildings and so on, this will be a part of that, saying we need a certain greening factor in the area, and then it'll be up to the developers to actually try and fit in as much as possible in the building project. So there are different ways of doing it. In Germany, they have a tax system where you get you pay more tax if you have hard surfaces.
Oh, we don't do that here. No taxes.
Well, you might consider doing it. it's actually not such a bad idea, but just saying that you can actually, maybe you could turn around and say you can reduce your tax by having green surfaces, because it will actually also help the amount of stormwater that you release from the building and so on. And it's one of the things that the Danish government has also tried to look into. It's not become possible to actually reduce the stormwater taxes or the fees that you pay, but that's what they do in Germany. You actually get a tax reduction if you have permeable surfaces, and they monitor it. So it is possible. There are different ways, different approaches to go about, whether you're talking about incentives or whether you're talking about punishing people by increasing their taxes if they don't. That's up to you.
Well, I know in the U.S. we tend not to like the taxation model, but what I am experiencing with people now is that many corporations have such a strong sustainability program that when they're going out to rent a space or buy a new office, one of the questions on their schedule is, what is your sustainability program? What is your approach to these kind of questions? So I'm conscious of developers beginning to be more conscious of this themselves because they are seeing an economic value to it. They are able to distinguish themselves from others by being able to say, we have a green program and this is what it consists of. I think there's an economic value to that for them.
It's become a marketing.
Yes, it's become part of that.
Yeah, if I could just quickly add, I mean, definitely for migrating bird species, for our pollinator corridors, one of the many benefits. The one thing that I think is interesting that I like to add that should be known is it's kind of this double-edged sword. We have immense financial benefits, structural benefits, environmental benefits, and there's such a robust suite of ways we can sell green roofs, which is beautiful to all the people in the room who are interested in green roofs and excited to be here. But from a developmental standpoint, unless you get someone who's really dreaming about these things, a lot of times the diverse nature of these projects almost makes them more complicated to explain to the every person or to the developer. It's not like your traditional solar panel where you say, this is how much it's going to cost, this is how much it's going to cost to install, and at this point you're going to hit your ROI and then you're going to start to make money. When you're including saying your roof's going to now be from a 20-year roof to a 60-year roof, plus you're going to be producing honey and you're going to be producing vegetables and you're going to be lowering your cooling bill, and you also have all these incentives and you also have these paybacks from these government programs, and your building's also worth more to renters. There's so many things to capture in the way to sell this that although it's a beautiful thing, it's also a very challenging thing to package in an easy way to talk to the public about. So a lot of times I find the most effective way to do this is to bring people to those sites. That's the really powerful sell. And then you can start to talk about these things because all these numbers and all this data is real, and it's much more advantageous to look into these new and exciting systems than conventional roofing methods. But you do have to kind of open the door, and the easier way to do that is generally to bring them to these dynamic sites that are very close to home here in New York City. I strongly urge you to check out some of these projects.
Yeah, I would second that. So I work in New York City public schools a lot, and one of the things that always strikes me is that most of the students that I talk with, most of the children I talk with, think of nature as something that exists somewhere else. So the idea of greening the city and making it more apparent that they actually live in an ecosystem and that this is the environment. The environment isn't somewhere else that is pristine. Seems to me to be a huge benefit both as we become a more urban society and as we try to imagine our commitment to sustainability going forward. But I guess one of the questions that jumps out at me, and this it goes to this public-private distinction, is you know, at least here in New York City, I would imagine there are tremendous insurance implications for both for just having a green roof, but also for opening space up to the public. And so I guess what I would ask is both about how do you navigate that divide between thinking about public access to formerly private spaces, and also how does that relate to the groundscape? How do you see the sort of greening of the top of buildings relating to initiatives that are happening at street level or ground level? It's a long, complicated question.
So let me try and give you a short answer to that. I think from the insurance perspective, we require people to sign a waiver when they go on the roof, which protects you to some degree. We also only take up small groups, no more than 30 people at a time. And we have at least two people from our staff with them at all times. So we limit our risk by the way in which we allow access. When we build the expansion of Javits, which is now has now begun, we will have a more accessible green roof that will be accessible to those who are attending conventions and meetings, but will not be accessible to the public. Again, a slightly limited access. The opportunity that exists for us as a building, and I believe for the city, is that if you're familiar with where Javits is, we're at 34th and 12th. That's the western, southwestmost location. If you think of what's at 34th and 12th, there's the High Line, there's Hudson River Park, and there's 12th Avenue. IMPA's original design for the Javits Center contemplated bringing a public walkway from the building across what was to be Westway, which was never built, to the Hudson River Park. The opportunity exists for us, using space that we currently occupy, to connect the High Line, the Hudson River Park, all the way up to 40th Street. How we do that is complicated, because we're a state property in New York City, and that can sometimes make life not easier, but a little more challenging. But the first thing we have to do is conceive of the idea, and then we go out and start to sell it to people in the mayor's office, in the governor's office, and demonstrate to them that there's a real value to the community for making this kind of investment. So that's how we then tie the greenscape, the ground level, with what happens on the roof, because we can make that connection from the ground level to the roof space, the new roof space in particular.
I think there's a difference whether you're talking about sort of a private residential building. There I don't see sort of public access. That could be sort of private for the residents within the building. But I don't know, actually I would like, if Metis, you had a slide where you showed the SEB bank and the whole thing, you had the that whole rooftop, which was a bank, high security thing that actually allowed this. It was the National Archive of Denmark, which is also a little bit high security. We have a lot of very important documents there. And then there's a hotel. These are the three things that actually own it. And you were able to create that, basically a public park on top of the roofs of those buildings, or at least in between those buildings, basically. And so I think it's about the choice. There are places where you can do them, make it public accessible, when you think it from the beginning. And there are places where you can't do it and shouldn't do it. But it's about thinking. I mean, nobody would have thought 20 years ago that the High Line Park would be what it is today. And I think it's about trying to look at the city in a different way and the way you construct buildings in the city. There are plenty of places where I could see green roofs, for instance, connecting buildings in also in New York, where you can have these public places, which would be like the High Line Park, a little bit above. You have a lot of ugly parking lots at corners here. Why not do something about them, where they actually become accessible for the public on top of these things and make them nicer? So I think it's about sort of twisting your head a little bit about how you look at accessibility for the public.
And just quickly to add to that, it's as you said, it's definitely twisting your ideas of conventional designs and realizing that there actually is quite a bit of flexibility even in the existing designs of facilities. We, of course, definitely recommend that you have to follow the regular codes. There are laws for how high the parapet has to be for safe access to buildings. There are lots of regulations, but within that, there's opportunities to optimize on these spaces. We'll go to roofs that can only hold X amount of weight safely, but they'll be covered in river wash stones. So you take away the river wash stones, suddenly you freed out this amount of weight that you can now put on a green roof. We have a building that doesn't have a safe parapet wall, it's down to your ankles, but a wall is very structurally sound, more so than a roof. So you build a green wall on that parapet, suddenly you have an ecological element that also now meets the safety code. And on top of that, it doesn't have to worry about the carrying capacity of the building because you're building it a vertical system on a wall. There's a lot of imaginative, creative space where you can really optimize on the wide range of buildings we have in the city to build interesting, sustainable pieces of architecture. But it takes some reimagining of what we think the rules are. And we definitely want to keep within those rules, but there are ways that we can comply with them without having to bend over backwards to do things that aren't convenient for sustainable projects.
How have you found in, I don't know if this is part of the experience in Copenhagen, but certainly listening to you, Alan, the thing that strikes me is we live in a city with dramatically unequal access to green space. And so, you're adding green space, and that's wonderful, but you're adding it to an area that's already one of the better served areas of New York City between the High Line and the Hudson River Park. And you know, the idea of connecting them is fabulous, but I live in Queens, and we don't have, we have an old railway track that we would love to turn into a similar kind of a park, but there's no, you know, the funding is really being directed to the wealthier parts of the city, and particularly the wealthier parts of Manhattan. Have you had to grapple with those kinds of issues? And you know, what do you see as a way out of that?
One of the things that Herbert also slightly touched upon our cloudburst management plan in Copenhagen. One of the things we're doing there is actually using that also as a possibility to upgrade some of the neighborhoods who have been lacking I mean, Jakob's company, they've made a great little park. It's just a small pocket park, basically, in Copenhagen, where we've created a place where there was no place before. It's become a social meeting point in an area which was undergoing urban renewal. So there are lots of opportunities if you think about, if you are also looking at creating a resilient city, a city that's supposed to be able to tolerate storms like Sandy and so on. You can use that for upgrading. Maybe your railway track can be an axis in a cloudburst branch that will lead water away from one area to another area, or for storing water during a storm or anything like that, and can also at the same time then be upgraded. That's one of the things that we're actually working with DEP about, is how can you take some of the ideas we've used in Copenhagen and transfer them to a New York context? And it and that can be used in also in upgrading some of the more deprived areas. We're actually working in an area of Southeast Queens out in Jamaica Bay, in the Jamaica area. And it's an area that's been lacking in sort of attention when it comes to public space. All of a sudden, you can
practice. And has tremendous water problems.
Yeah, also. But we are using the water problems. Well, of course, we want to solve the water problems. They're the reason for that. But at the same time, with the same amount of money, you can also upgrade the neighborhood, which is one of the things that could really be a part of. I mean, I know your mayor wants to have one New York. So, I mean, that could be part of his agenda also.
So I would just say that clearly there's a large part of this is political will. But what you're doing here tonight is part and parcel of educating everyone about the value of green roofs. And I think we have to see more of this kind of activity, which will help inform the public opinion, and public opinion will eventually influence the political will. I'm not going to get myself into trouble by talking about the political will, but unless you go there, then it really is very difficult to do. I mean, in our case, in the case of the Javits Center, we had a visionary architect, Bruce Fowle of FX Fowle, who saw not only the need to renovate the building, but also to renovate it in a sustainable fashion. So not only did he put on a green roof, he also reclad the building with bird reflective glass. We were the biggest killer of birds in New York City. And as a result of the glass that we put on the building, we reduced our bird collisions by 90%. So you need someone with that kind of vision, that kind of leadership, and then you need a receptive customer. Javits at the time was a receptive customer, but that was a happy coincidence. I sometimes say that we're the accidental green roof. It wasn't that we went out to build a green roof, it was just that the conditions came together at that time. That was in 2008. I think in 2017, the world is a different place, and there's a much greater consciousness about the need for this, a much greater awareness of the value of it, but there's still a long way to go.
So can we talk just a little bit about how you see green roofs integrating into other cloudburst control mechanisms like bioswales and, you know, other options? I mean, certainly there's a big initiative right now in the city to install bioswales. You know, what else do you see as possibilities? What else have you done? How do these things tie together? Oops.
Regarding stormwater solutions in with green roof, for a daily rain, everyday rain, green roof is sufficient. It will hold back the water, use the water. About cloudburst, it's a little bit more complicated. What you actually do is putting a sponge on top of the building, and it's very efficient absorbing rain. A cloudburst is normally in Denmark, it's only 15 millimeter within 30 minutes. It's the definition of cloudburst in Copenhagen. And
they can be harder than that.
They can be very much harder than that. And it probably would work, but if the sponge is wet, it wouldn't work at all. Mm. So it's a little bit difficult to plan for green roofs to handle a cloudburst situation. It's much easier on the ground.
And we haven't, I mean, we use green roofs a lot for stormwater retention, like in backyards and on houses, but that's more part of our program of disconnecting, which is the same as you have got here in New York with the bioswales and the green infrastructure program. It's about handling smaller rain events and sort of getting stormwater out of the sewer system on a daily basis to prevent sewer overflows into the harbor and things like that. And it's much more complicated when it as Jakob says, when it comes to the bigger events, because very often you will have had a lot of rain before the cloudburst, and so you'll have a wet system. But it is a part of it, but we still have to make sure that we've got a system that can handle it, can take over when it's not enough anymore. So you have to have, you cannot rely on green roofs to solve the problem. You have to have another system or a complementary system that will back it up in case of overflowing. I hope I'm right with the engineers in that.
Well, of course, our default here is not a very good one. You know, the combined sewer overflow system is not sustainable in terms of really any matrix you would want to measure it by. So, you know, anything we do to improve it, of course, would be a great event. Yeah.
You've got the Clean Water Act here in the U.S. sort of asking for so far. I know that there's somebody in D.C. working on that, but that has been the regulatory framework that you've been using for getting sort of stormwater out of the system to make sure that you reduce the number of overflows, and by using green infrastructure you are using part of you're getting part of the way, but you need probably more than that to get all the way. I mean, in Copenhagen we started in the 90s with reducing combined sewer overflows. And the first thing we built, I mean, we built gray infrastructure at that time, huge retention reservoirs along the harbor, reducing the number of combined overflows to an extent where it after 10 years, we had a water quality in the harbor which made it possible for people to go swimming. You can fish, you can grow oysters and mussels there and actually eat them. I mean, even though they are still, I would still prefer to eat them from further out, but actually if you look at the content of heavy metals, it's within the acceptable range. So it's actually, we've come a very long way. What we are working on now is actually also making sure that the increased amount of rain does not increase the number of sewer overflows. We still want to be able to swim in the harbor, even with climate change. And one of the things that by actually separating the sewer water from the storm water, we will maybe have more overflows, but it will be with cleaner water that it will not be mixed sewage water and storm water. And I think that's a very important part of it, is making sure that one thing is the things you've got now, but you also have to look towards the future to say, okay, what are the expected climate patterns here, and what do you need, what kind of system do you need in 50 years time?
Yeah, so we have, I was just in Miami for a conference on climate change, and in Florida they're not allowed to say climate change. And they're not allowed to say sea level rise. So they talk about sunny day flooding there. Sunny day flooding. And so there are tremendous adaptations in the infrastructure of the cities in southern Florida to respond to sunny day flooding. But we can still say climate change here in New York. So let's talk about it. Let's talk about the carbon impacts of green roofs? I mean, what is your, we heard some wonderful details in the two presentations, but, you know, and if you have things to add, by all means, add them. But, you know, what are you anticipating? What do you see? What have you measured? What can you tell us?
Well, I will rely on Rebecca to give exact numbers, but one of the things we've been doing as we've gone through the last few years with Drexel, Fordham, and the others that we're working with is to measure all of those impacts, and we have achieved a significant amount of tonnage of carbon replacement through what we've done. We are producing our first sustainability report, which will be issued by Javits next month. And that will have a full data set in there about all of the achievements. But it's not that I'm trying to hide the number, it's just I don't know the number at this point.
I don't have exact details, but I mean, one of the reasons that we are also promoting green roofs is to reduce the, especially have the insulating effect, that's sort of the current, that it will reduce the need for heating in the winter. But eventually, even though, I mean, we don't have the same problem as you've got here in New York with very hot days, when I talk about urban heat island effect and that we will eventually have a climate like Paris, people normally say, bring it on, why is it taking you so long? but when you look at it from sort of a planner's point of view, it will be an issue in Denmark also. And so we can see that green roofs might have an effect also in reducing urban heat island will also, on the long term, reduce the need for cooling. We have very little cooling in Copenhagen right now of buildings. We try to work with district cooling instead of air conditioning, but we can see that it might be an issue in the future if we have more of these hot summers. We haven't had one in quite a while, so we seem to get cold summers and warm winters.
Rebecca, can I just reflect? When I entered New York 2 days ago, the federal officer checking my passport, he said, "Well, why are you here, lady?" Well, we work with nature-based design to reduce food CO2 emission. And he said, "Well, you know, you read the news. We don't believe in CO2 here in this country anymore." So I'm really happy to be here that somebody do believe that we need to work on it. But he was fun. He was nice. But I think one issue is what you touched upon, Alan, is that you actually empower the city government to operate, to make a framework, because a city is a flow of money all the time. It's a business, it's a behavior, it's all that kind of stuff. So make a very simple framework for the city to demand of the investment and the flow of money to do better. I know it's easier said than done, but and I know that we're a smaller city in Copenhagen than you are, but there's surely, I mean, just from these 2 days, there is a lot of empowerment already. And looking at your green roof and with the Gaia, who's also represented here today, it's just to connect some of the small dots that are already there and actually make it, and the Javits Center, I haven't seen your green roof, but I hope for an invitation. So to sort of connect the dots and also be aware of that, how are we doing and make it, communicate it.
I think that's really important. I think advocacy is something that is very much underutilized in this area. As I mentioned before, the New York City Green Roofs group is intending to try and rectify some of that. But that's being led by the Audubon Society. They're very interested in birds, but they see the value of green roofs as a... So it's not necessarily the Environmental Defense Fund or any of the other groups that you would expect who are leading this charge, and we need to work with them to be part of the conversation, because that conversation will be what eventually changes the political will, which will eventually change the outcome.
John, much like the other speakers, I don't have a exact number prepared for exactly how much carbon all our plant spaces are sequestering, nor a lovely metric. No, and I don't have the how many central parks that would equate to make that number more digestible, but it's definitely a significant impact. And also, it's a very achievable way to do so between all of our tree plants and between all our public park spaces. And it's interesting because it's a great space to work in because it can easily be modified. We're in a unique city with so many different typologies, so many different hardscapes and accessible spaces and green streets and playgrounds and biosoils and rooftops. There's so many different unique spaces that we can create these dynamic green areas in. And with that, the versatility is immense, and these environmental goals can easily be achieved. And it's very much an evolving dialogue. It's been amazing working with the Danish Clean Tech Hub and all of our representatives to expand our understanding of how we might achieve that further.
So I've been busy looking at the clock thinking that, oh, we have until 8:30, so there's tons of time for everybody else to talk, but I apologize. So please, we have a lot of experts in the room. Please.
I was just going to fill in again. That's about 430 square miles of parkland. It's about 80,000 tons a year of carbon captured. I'm getting back to Alan's point, and the obviously we'd like to have the laws, but the money makes a huge difference. So I'm just in a completely inaccessible source. I've just published a paper on basically green infrastructure soils and looked at New York City altogether. And if you take the gray water in New York City, grant me that it's 600 million gallons a day out of the 1.2 billion gallons of water we use. We pay something like $2.4 million a day to treat that. It's worth something like $320 million a day in cooling capacity of evapotranspired. It's six times the peak load requirement of New York City. So there's got to be a way to use this. It's got to be in front of people. We have no idea. But it's just every student in physics learns this at their freshman year. Anyway, it's available.
I was wondering if there's any thought given to encouraging developers to build green roofs voluntarily by letting them rent them out then as working vegetable farms, and if so, would zoning be needed in residential areas in New York?
I don't know the answer to the question, but I will tell you that when we expand the building, we're looking at, what we will look at is whether we should plant with native grasses or whether we should plant tomatoes. It's going to be a debate within our organization as to which makes the most sense, and we will look at it from an economic perspective. What value can we actually create by doing either of those two things? And we'll put a value on the, not just on the price of tomatoes, but also on the value there is to the community in having a grass-scaped sculpture.
We actually have an organization in Copenhagen called Tau Tomate, which translates directly into roof tomato. And it's basically about growing vegetables, I mean, starting on sheds in the backyards and so on, and it's sort of expanded. It's not about renting out the space, but it's actually about, it's a grassroots organization promoting the cultivation of plants in the city. So we've got the roof tomato organization if you want to meet them.
Yeah, at least from my understanding of the situation, this is where I want the discussion to go. This is starting to think to what we're going to do tomorrow with emerging ideas. We're not at the legal point where we would say, well, you can only grow this but not that. We're still worrying about parapet walls and if we're too close to where a fire ladder might go over. So I still think it's very much in the realm of it's up to you.
And then we have a question. Sure. I was just going to respond to your question or comment about roof gardens, but my company is involved in developing a project right now in Brooklyn and Williamsburg, and 6 by 10 foot plot up on the third floor of this project is going for $100 a month. So the incentives are starting to show up.
So I know that Copenhagen is on track to become a zero carbon city. To what extent can we integrate roofs and other spaces with distributed energy, with photovoltaic and small wind and perhaps other ways of doing things?
Are Well, one of the things we have offered to be as a large green roof in New York City is a test bed for any of those things. So we are, as I said, working with a variety of different groups now to see where we can be of help to that. If our roof is not accessible to the public, perhaps it can be through scientific experimentation. It can create value for the public through those kind of efforts. So if you have a small wind project, I'm very interested in where we are right on the west side. We get lots of wind from New Jersey. So we've done some wind studies just to see how much we can expect. So we'd be happy to talk about that with anyone.
We don't work with these small-scale energy projects in Copenhagen because we've got a large-scale energy production sort of centralized, which we are making carbon neutral. So it's not that much. I mean, there have been a few experiments with sort of solar panels and things like that, but mainly a lot of our energy, most of our energy production is done centrally. 98% of people in Copenhagen are connected to our district heating system, for instance. So that's, I mean, we don't have that individual heating and so on in buildings.
Yeah, again, this is where I'd like the conversation to begin to evolve on our facility. So a little bit of background, I operate at a 5-row building on Randall's Island. It has the world's most diverse green roof, over 30 unique systems staged side by side to see how any and everything that we've identified in the industry performs under similar conditions, under the same climate, under the same care regimen, under the same operating conditions on top of the same building. And one of the really powerful pieces of equipment we have up there is synergistic models of solar panels mounted on green roofs. We have small-scale pilots that are very favorable. Your 2 seconds of science for this lecture, you imagine your cell phone or your laptop, when it starts to get very hot, it's not in a happy place, it's lagging, it's shutting off. Same rule applies to your solar panels. After about 74 degrees Fahrenheit ambient temperature, your gains on the panel are starting to drop. Your plants, just by nature, are evapotranspirating. They're cooling the air around you. So if you're clever in your design and you put your plants right next to your plants are passively cooling the panel, making sure they get optimal energy gains. Your panel also, if you put the right plants in it, could potentially, the panel can be a little house for the plants. It can buffer inclement weather conditions. You can make a beautiful, functional, and economically viable synergistic systems. And we proved that with small-scale pilots, and now we're looking to scale those efforts up with amazing community partners, such as the Javits, seeing the true potential of bringing those systems on a large scale, which I think is absolutely there.
Good evening. General Manager of Intervine, we train and employ low-income community members that face significant employment barriers to build and maintain green infrastructure. And we've been working to try and develop green infrastructure programs through the city's existing incentive programs. While the city's committed hundreds of millions of dollars to green infrastructure and private property, property owners have been very slow to engage in these programs. And so I think you've touched on, throughout the evening, some of the different incentive programs around the world and around the country, tax credits, mandates. In D.C., there's a secondary market for stormwater credits. Do you have a sense of what the most attract, as we try and put pressure on our elected officials to step up our green infrastructure, Graham, what's the most attractive incentive structure for private property owners?
That's a good question to wrap us up with. I mean, as we've kind of been talking, it's such an amazing beast. You imagine in your mind's eye what a green roof is. Everyone in this room is going to come up with a different image. There are so many variables to a green roof that can be custom tailored to your site, to what's relevant to that region, to what's relevant to your budget, to what's relevant to your clients, what's relevant to your organization, to what you want to sell your facility to be. So the paybacks can also be custom tailored to what might be most beneficial to getting the system constructed ASAP. If it's stormwater retention, you can create a dynamic system that's catered to hold as much water as possible. If it's carbon sequestration, you can create intensive plants. There's a lot of play, there's a lot of variability in the stuff, and that's what's really one of the key strengths to green roofs. People have this bias in their mind that they're very complicated and it's this untouchable, it's this new thing and we can't do it. But there's so many options out there that it's impossible that there isn't a green roof that couldn't work on your facility if you just open your mind to the wide range of options and benefits and paybacks and incentives. So it's really on us now to begin to imagine all the options out there and realize that these technologies are tangible, they're being staged here in our home city, they are viable, they are beneficial and they are real, and we just kind of have to open our minds to that now. So the answer is what you want it to be.
Maybe if I could just make a comment on the photovoltaic performance, and you have the wind situation, windmills and so on. It's all technology, and what does it bring back to people, to life-enhancing qualities? In Denmark, we had a huge investment on our health sector. It's kind of, the amount is insane. But instead of thinking about technologies, you can go by common sense. And we did a renovation of a huge hospital in Copenhagen, where we, on all the glass facades, included nature, green, trees, etc., as part of the facade heating cooling system. And you can actually limit the heating cooling electricity to 40% by thinking about that. So remember common sense in this. Remember just to go back to logics. There's a lot of common sense and easy things to actually select that enhance life quality. And for this hospital, it's enhancing for the the rehab of people being sick. Yeah.
Sorry, I think it's two E's. It's economics and education. I think economics is what drives a developer's decisions to what he or she does. So I think that an economic model needs to be developed to show that there is real value to this, and we hope again through the New York Green Council, Green Roof Council, that we can kind of provide data to help support that. But then I think education is the other element of this. I was in Geneva just a few weeks ago at the Geneva Auto Show. I won't say every vehicle was an electric vehicle or a hybrid, but pretty damn close. If you go to the New York International Auto Show, which is taking place now, you will see a very different percentage of electric vehicles. And that disconnect or that gap is part of what we have to address in the education program. We are still some way from getting there.
It's actually, I think your question is interesting. I was thinking while the other was speaking that if you had asked me 2 years ago, I would have said regulations would be the important thing. But the way the world is turning now is very interesting. Also, what's happening here in the U.S. is that the your new president and all his doings. The interesting thing is that when we, for instance, work with U.S. cities, is that what we're seeing now is that the market is ahead of politicians. It's a new situation, one we haven't seen before. It's the market. It's not, yes, they're talking about, in some countries in Europe, wanting to have fossil-free cars in the future, but none have actually sort of had the regulatory. They're working on it in Oslo, in Norway, but it's not there yet. But the manufacturers, they're there. I mean, it might be that Trump is talking about bringing back coal, but if you ask people, I mean, it's the wind energy, it's the solar energy that's on the move, what the market is interested in. So actually, I think it's a very strange situation coming from an almost socialist communist country to see that it's actually a development driven by market rather than regulations. And it gives me a little bit of a hope.
Yeah, I'm not sure what the sides mean, but okay, so I'm a landscape architect and I design roofs in New York City. I was counting, I think I've done about 10 within about three blocks up here, and lots more. So I think one of the issues for me is when discussing green roofs, there's the definition of green roof, and then there's kind of the misunderstanding of what it is or might be. And so occupied space and roof gardens are this whole thing that, in a sense, I mean, you certainly talked about with Copenhagen with your incredible designs there. But we have a lot of private, entire co-op roofs of large buildings that are developing roof gardens. I just did a solar photovoltaic cell pergola and structures incorporated into a townhouse roof that also had meadows and other plants that. So in other words, there's the green roof. There's the definition of what a green roof is. But for New York City, occupiable space, gardens that people want to go to, hang out in, whether it's part of restaurants, children's gardens, this is what kind of sells. And it is being done. It's just that it's being done in kind of, it's not being done at the scale that it should be done. So I wondered when Mr. Steele said economics and education, I think that there's now a rule in that libraries need to have open space, that when they build, when they adapt libraries, new libraries have to have outdoor space they have access to. And I was just wondering about whether something like that or new structures or adapting schools would be a place to start, because sometimes in terms of legality, where it seems that sometimes we can get a little bit of movement and innovation in those kind of pilot programs. I was just wondering about that.
Well, I think you're right in the sense that public spaces are more easily mandated because they don't necessarily need to go out and tell a developer how to do something. The mayor or the governor can make a determination that they want to see changes made in the buildings that they control. The buildings you mentioned, schools, a convention center. So they won't solve the entire problem, but certainly there is an opportunity within there at that political level to address those particular assets.
And I know that City Council is very interested in green roofs in schools. Mm.